Y'all ever heard of Mayor Hawthorne? I love the way the dudes are dancing, because that's the way we danced 100 years ago. Listen to the lyrics, they're great. He's cute, look at him, got that little side swoop thing going. Few housekeeping things before we get going. Do you guys know the difference between works, W-O-R-K-S, and word, W-O-R-D, in formatting? Some of you are still insisting on doing it in works. I'm going to start counting off. I'm going to start sending it back. And a lot of times when I send something back that's not correct, then it gets bumped to the tail end of the line to get corrected, because I don't want to keep going back and checking. Okay? So please correct this. Beginning with the midterm, if you don't use a 12-point font, okay, 11 is not 12. Use a 12-point font, use 1.5 or double spacing, okay? Starting with a midterm, if you don't do one of those things, I'll put your name on it, you're going to get points deducted right off the top. Boom, boom, boom. Do not work with one another. Now, just a few tips. And this is what I kind of gleaned from grading your week six, or looking at your week six. We typically use the past tense when we're referring to people being promoted, arrested, found, whatever. Because we're usually writing about something that's already happened. All right? The officer arrested. The CEO promoted. The president said, Usher released a new record. The university announced. Okay? Now, actually, that one, I should have said, university officials announced. I was doing that in a hurry. I really should have said that. Now, you'll see that used a lot. When you have an entity as the noun, like an organization, and then a verb, I try to stay away from that. I'd rather see university officials announce, because the university can't talk. These are the terms that I want you to think in when you're writing. And I know that a lot of times we write like we hear people talk, and people don't talk too well these days. I hear that. But remember this when you're writing those releases. It's in the past tense. And this is in your book. That's very important. People are appointed, promoted, and elected. They are not appointed as, or promoted as, or elected as is not there. Although you might think it sounds a little weird, that's the way we write it. Appointed Lucinda Smith, communication specialist, not as communication. You can have the there. The voters elected Jerry Springer mayor. Well, I think he was mayor somewhere at one time before he went to TV. But you don't say the voters elected Jerry Springer as mayor. And that is a big mistake. And you see professionals make this all the time. And all it does is add words to it and make your reader have to digest more than they should. So we don't want to be using as. Forget that one. Contrary to what Mitt Romney said, corporations are not people. Okay? They cannot appoint, they can't promote, announce, bestow, hire, cry, laugh, empathize, dislike, love, or anything else we humans do. So, when you go talking about a corporation, you got to use somebody in that corporation. A name, an office that they hold, something. Columbus State University can't, I'm trying to remember what somebody said on one of their releases. Columbus State University is building. No, you can't do that. You got to come up with something else. Officials from Columbus State University announced plans to build. But the university can't build something. It is an entity, a nebulous thing, an umbrella that encompasses this whole organization. All right, these are correct. The CEO of Microsoft announced the acquisition of Storify. Officials from McDonald's admit the food they serve is nasty. Okay, incorrect. Microsoft announced acquisition of Storify. Now, you might see that in some places, but it's not right, because Microsoft can't talk. These are the questions I want you to ask yourself when you're writing. Is what I've got as a subject, can it talk, can it think, can it do? No. You can't say McDonald's admits their food is nasty. Okay, events aren't scheduled at certain times on certain days. The clinic is happening Monday, March 2nd, 4 p.m. That's all you got to do. You don't have to put a bunch of prepositions in there. You don't have to say the clinic is happening on Monday, March 2nd at 4 p.m. Those are wasted words. If you're on a word limit, those two count against you. If you can get rid of words, do so. Okay? And that's something, you know, that I'll count off on. All right. And this is something, you know, that the book did a lot. You know, on those rewrites of the leads, they use the book, the author used the passive voice a lot versus the active voice. Now, if you're unclear what that is, it's a great section in your grammar book. Whenever possible, we want to use that active voice. Remember, Dr. Hayden's admonishes us to use action when we write. Well, this is how you do it. Verbs act. So rather than saying was appointed, just say the CEO appointed her. That has much more oomph to it. You're taking it from the passive to the active. The passive is was appointed. The active is appointed. The voters elected Jerry Springer versus Jerry Springer was elected. So whenever you use that passive voice, look at it and go, okay, can I rework this sentence so that I'm showing action rather than passivity? And that's what you want in your writing. It also sounds a lot less formal when you use that action. Once again, you're losing a word. And if you're on a word constraint there, if your editor says no more than 300 words, if you can get rid of a whole bunch of a, ats, owns, the, was, and were's, then you can have some better words, have some that mean more. You make it interesting by finding that human element. Find a person. Find somebody that this affects, and I said affect with an A because it is a verb, and effect is a noun. Somebody posted that on the Facebook page. I like that. I like that. Find some person that is really affected by this or involved in it. Have that's what your story is centered around. You're going to get a lot more readers. Find a good story beneath that dry verbiage. Whoever said a press release or a news release has to be boring and dry? Nothing could be more interesting than lead writing with Professor Avery now, Jeremy. Okay. Focus on why it matters. Why is this newsworthy? Yes. Why is it interesting? Why is it newsworthy? Remember this, guys. The purpose of writing anything is to have it read. Now, if when you're proofing what you've written, if it's boring and puts you to sleep, guess what? It's going to have the same effect on everybody else. Make it interesting. Give it some juice. I was amazed at how many people, when we would find an interesting website, I think the one that got the most votes was at Celebrity Juice, not from Concentrate. And a straight news lead in that first sentence, bam, you know what you're talking about. You know what the article is about. With a feature, it might not be in the first sentence. It might be in the second paragraph. It's going to be down a ways. Now, it may still be a news article, but it has a feature style lead. Now, myself, as a writer, even when I was a reporter and I was doing a straight news piece, if I could come up with a feature lead, I did. I always tried because I knew I was going to get my readers hooked in a lot better than if I said, Tuesday night, the Harris County Commission met. Well, okay. But if I talked about something that went on there or somebody that was there or something that happened in that very first sentence, that's going to get their attention. Now, that example there, straight news. New plans for the old Ledger Enquirer building are on the drawing board of the new owner, Columbus State University. It's still a news story. It's a very straight lead. I even use a little conversational tone. There's nothing wrong with that, guys, unless your boss says, I want this formal. If your boss says, I want this formal, do it formal. But if you can write in a conversational tone, you're going to be read more. Now, a more feature style. Communication, journalism, media. Professions engaged in an ever-changing landscape. What was in yesterday is out today. And who is cutting edge today could be gone tomorrow. Oh, I could be talking about anything. But you see where I'm going with this lead. Okay. And then in the next paragraph, get a little closer. Not only must ideas change, but facilities must adapt. You're getting a little bit more of a hint. And officials at Columbus State University are answering the challenge. So you go, oh, okay, I'm getting even closer here to what's really going on. And then I come right in with a quote from Dana Gibson. We're going to build one of the best communication centers in the state, said CSU Communication Department Chair Dana Gibson. And you will notice that all those caps, why? Why is CSU Communication Department Chair capitalized? And then she continues the quote, thanks to generous alumni and a sizable grant from Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, our students will have the best resources in the state. I know. Okay, but now we know what we're talking about. Anytime you can come up with a feature lead, I don't care if you're writing about a PTA meeting. Do it. Now, where this guy that wrote the text came up with these names, I would never know. I don't even know how to pronounce them. Now, these are a couple from the, you know, you had to do the rewrites on exercise 8.3. This was the last batch you did on exercise 8.3. And like I said, I always lean toward a more human element if I can, and a less formal approach if I can when I'm writing, because I know that the 98.99% of the folks we're writing for are not formal, and they're very conversational. And that's what they want to read. Same thing. Customer service and maintenance at the Eastern Cable Company is a big deal. And yesterday, company officials appointed Euphrasia Gilhooley, the new director of the department. Not as the new director, just appointed her the director. Having a transition, those ands, buts, howevers, although, those are very powerful words to take the reader from one train of thought to the next so that you don't lose them. That's why it's called transition. This is not English class. We're writing for the masses in here. That's why they call it mass media. Okay? And you can do that. That gives it a lot of power when you write that way, when you use the and the but. And like I said, I don't think it's going to be too long for because joins the ranks. That's a transition. You made that statement, it's a big deal. And this is what they did. In other words, she's a big deal. And that's the point you want to get across, because this is a news release about her getting appointed. Okay, the one about the Toyota place. Toby Tyler's Toyota is celebrating 25 years of business with an open house next Monday. Join the crew on James Pike for refreshments all day, starting at 9 a.m. and continuing until 9 p.m. So much has changed. And that's why I said that media landscape is ever-changing, because it is. The rules that governed us yesterday don't govern us today, necessarily. Unless it's some of the AP ones and some of the grammar ones that are hard and fast, you know. But even the grammar and style changes, like with and, but, before, whatever. Now, on this next one, and when we're doing lead writing, you are free to make up names. Did you have a question? Another question? Tara. I mean, to give it some life, if you want to bring in a human element and pretend that you are actually digging, in fact, that's fine with me. Make up some names. I don't know these folks. Jake Smith, Alex Jones, Eli Whitney, Brandon Keyes, Daniel O'Keefe. Five young men who are starters for Haven High School Championship basketball team and the coaches for a five-day clinic for kids. So admit, you start off with those local names. They're like going, yeah, I know those guys. Oh, they're following that team. And then you see they're doing this clinic. So you start out with something that you know is going to get their attention. So when we're doing this lead writing, have at it with making up names and using people. I think that's excellent. That shows me that you're looking for that human element. All right, Melinda Hobermeyer started working at O'Malley Enterprises when she was a college intern. Immediately you start out with some interest about Melinda Hobermeyer. You know she's been working there since, I mean, she wasn't even paid when she started working. And yesterday she got some good news. And then I hit right with a quote. Because that validates it. That gives you some validation when you use a quote like that. Her loyalty and hard work have paid off for her, said Aloysius O'Malley, President and Chief Executive Officer. I have appointed her Senior Vice President for Corporate Communications. And, you know, and so, I mean, you immediately see this woman that's, but you know, started out as an intern and now she's this. You want to read the rest of the story. And it's just a news release. But that's how you get your reader hooked in. So I am quite fine with you using, unless I tell you to write a straight news release, news lead. If I'm telling you, just do me some leads for these stories, have at it with this stuff. If I say get creative, that's what I mean. Get creative. Okay, now, example for that second one. The second part of the assignment, when I just gave you the made-up stuff about robberies. The robberies in the downtown CSU student residences have reached an alarming rate in the last 48 hours. Ellipsis. Alarming enough, or you can have a dash there. I just like, a lot of times I do the dot. It's easier. Can you use a dash there? That would be good. Alarming enough for university officials and law enforcement to hold an emergency Q&A session tonight, 7 p.m., Riverside Theater. And then I come right in with a quote. Quotes are what lend your story authenticity. Okay, it makes it valid, it makes it real, it gives it credibility. So I immediately come in with a quote. We cannot emphasize the importance of coming out for this meeting, said Sarah Bellows, Director of Student Affairs. We have a crisis on our hands, and we need everyone's help to get things under control. You immediately say, okay, guys, this is a big deal. This is trouble. Everybody needs to come together. And that's what you want to do on a story like this. You want to get that point across. So, even though we're programmed a lot of times when somebody says news release, our brains click into this thing. How can I write the most boring thing in the world? That's not what we want to do. We want to write something interesting, something with an angle, a good story. Okay? Now, any questions? People, if you don't understand that difference between news style and feature, not the story, the lead. A lead needs to get their attention. Straight news is going to be a sentence. Did everybody hear that? A straight news lead is one sentence. A feature lead, style lead, you give a little bit more, like that one that I did, you know, about the communication, you know. You give a little bit more, and they're kind of going, wait a minute, what are we talking about here? Irony is huge. Opposites are huge. I was listening to the radio when I was coming down here. The number of songs that are popular that have this opposite message going on, like everything that kills me makes me feel alive. It's the opposite, but it's so catchy. Everything that kills me makes me feel alive. Yes, a good song. And then the other one that says, you don't miss your lover until she's gone, or you know, you don't miss the sun until it snows, you don't miss home until you're on the road, or Jason Ratz, or isn't that? Yeah. You know, I mean, it's all built on opposites. So irony is, that is an enormous attention getter, because your reader's going, what? Hot, cold, alive, dead? You know, they're seeing that irony there. So anytime you can build that into a lead or a story, the better. And I know that some people weren't clear on the assignment, and that's okay. I guess it was the way I wrote it. There were two parts. I wanted you to take, it's okay if you didn't do it this way. I wanted you to take those bullet points in 8.1 and do me some leads, 2 points, and do me two leads on that. And then I wanted you to take that stuff that I made up and do a news on that. And some people just construed it as only doing the robbery thing, okay? Which is fine. You still get the practice. This is so you get this practice because you need it not only for the midterm, but what we're going to be doing for the next couple of weeks after the midterm. You don't have to give any statistics. In a straight news lead, you don't want to give any numbers. You don't want to give any money about how much it's going to cost, anything about how much it's going to cost, how much it's going to raise. That's in your story. It's just, bam, they're going to do it. Okay, now your feature. Good. She even went in there about how it fell. It collapsed. It just got so old, it just collapsed. Well, she made that up. That's fine, though. Good feature. Then she went into the quote from Dr. Gibson about building a new one. So those were good. She started it with a question, and a lot of teachers are going to say, do not start with a question. I think sometimes it's perfectly okay. You don't want to get in the habit of every single thing you write starting with a question. But she said, what do students at Columbus State University, $16.8 million, and new technology have in common? That's a great way to start, immediately going, well, I don't know, what? And then she answers it. That's an excellent, very good lead. Okay. I'll pull hers up, but it was good because the one on Kubernetes really had something that just grabbed your attention, like students suspected in rash of robberies or something like that. So immediately, you know, if you're looking at that and you're going, what? Somebody's doing this? That's going to really get your attention. And that's what you want to happen with that. And she took that approach. Are the students doing this? And that's what she honed in on. You have to lead the horse to the water. We obviously can't make them drink, but we sure do have to lead them there. I have not been active on my blog at all because I've been so busy with classes, but I'll have these folks that'll send me an email or Facebook or something going, I don't know how to find that picture, you know, or where's that picture on your blog? How do I get to that picture? You know, and I go, you have to hover on that little thing that's highlighted and click it, and that'll take you somewhere. You know, you obviously can't put that in a blog as I'm writing. I can't put in parentheses, click on this link. But you do have to lead your readers there. So that was very good. That's great. Planning for Columbus State University's new state-of-the-art. She got that in that sentence. You want everybody to know this is not just your run-of-the-mill, everyday new building. She got that in at the very beginning. Now your feature. She started out, big changes are coming to downtown Columbus. Well, since that's something that everybody's been so excited about, the revitalization of the downtown area, that's a great way to start it. Alan did his pretty much that same way because people are attracted to that because when it first began, everybody was going, this is never going to work. You know, downtown Columbus has been dead far too long. There is no way to revive it. So now that it's working, it's the newest thing to be excited about. So that's a great way to grab that reader's attention. Okay, Katie, do your robbery thing. Very good. Right straight to the point. That angle of we think this might be an inside job, that's huge. That gets because the worst thing you want to realize is that somebody that's living with you or around you is a thief. So that immediately gets everybody's attention. That was very good. I mean, like I said, I've just done these first six or seven, and I was very, very pleased with them. So this tells me that it's clicking with you what you're supposed to do with these leads. Now, if you're still not sure, go online and Google examples of good leads. You will get some sites that have some great examples to read. Because that's what's going to make you a better writer. It's not me lecturing to you. It's not you reading the text. And that's it. You got to read other writers. Like I've said, the best way to become a good writer is to read good writers. So Google that and get examples of good leads. Go to stories that attract your attention and go, what is it about the story that got my attention? And then you can then translate that into your own work. Now, on your midterm, you'll have some rewrites. I'll probably have some leads that I write that I want you to rewrite. I may have some sentences that don't use simple language, don't have neutral language, aren't objective, that I want you to rewrite. And then I'll probably have one or two, it just depends on how, you know, my numbers, of where I give you bullet points, like I did on this assignment. These are some things going on, and I'll tell you to write a lead for a certain kind of publication. And that would be different. If you're writing a lead for the student newspaper, you're going to approach it from a different angle than if you're writing it for the Ledger Inquirer. If you're writing it for an online site that's kind of hip with just a very young audience, you're going to have a different approach on that lead than the Ledger Inquirer. You have to think about your market and what they're looking for, what's going to attract their attention, what their trend is at that time. So practice on that, and I'll finish these. Week 7, this batch that we worked on today that we went over, I'll finish those in the morning and get them back to you. So if you have any questions on them, you'll have time. If you want to redo them, you'll have time. But once again, the most important thing that I can say to you about your midterm, don't wait until 9 o'clock Wednesday night to do this thing. Not that it is a long, drawn-out thing, but you can't do a good job if you do it, you know, just that one sit-down at it. Now, do you have any questions before I let you go out into the weather? You know, this weather that's brought to you by 50 Shades of Grey, because we are in 50 Shades of Grey, day in and day out. I've never seen such a gray landscape in my life. Any questions? Everybody's clear on it? Okay. If you have something you want to ask me after class, that's fine. And online, guys, email me if you have any questions. She's filling. Okay? Y'all have a great week next week, and I will see you Monday, March 9th. No meeting next week. Thank you very much.